So, we already know that ILP is not equal to IPC on any real processor. Actually, it can be, but it's not necessarily so, and that is because ILP is really the IPC on a perfect processor that does perfect branch prediction and only has to follow data dependencies. So now, let's look at an example of a program and a real processor and see basically how do we determine ILP and how do we determine the IPC. So this is our program, and now let's look at what the processor looks like. So our processor is two issue, meaning it can handle two instructions per cycle, out of order superscalar, which means that it doesn't need to execute instructions exactly in program order. And let's say that it only has one multiplication unit and two units that can do add, subtract, XORs, etc. For our ILP, we can just ignore all of this because the ILP, again, is just the property of a program. So we have to just obey dependencies. There is a data dependence here, and that's only really the only dependence that we have. So as far as ILP is concerned, we can do this in two cycles. This, 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 and this would be done in the first cycle, and then this would be done in the second cycle, because it depends on the instruction that is done in the first cycle. So we have five instructions over two cycles, gives us 2.5. In contrast, the IPC for this processor needs to consider all the limitations of this processor. So we have this instruction can be done in the first cycle. This one cannot because of a dependence. So for the IPC, we still have to obey all the dependencies. Plus, we have to also worry about the other limitations of the processor. This is an out-of-order processor, so we are not doing this, but we can still look further because we can do instructions out-of-order. The XOR can be done because we have two add, subtract, etc. units, so we can do this in the first cycle too. This instruction can be done in the first cycle because we can use the multiplier, but for example, this instruction here cannot be done in the first cycle, unlike when we computed the ILP. It cannot be done because we only have two add, subtract, XOR, etc. units, and we have already consumed both of them in the first cycle for the add and the XOR. So in the second cycle now, we can do this and this. So it turns out that our IPC is still five instructions over two cycles equals 2.5, but it doesn't have to be that way. For example, if this processor only had one add, subtract, XOR unit, we would now have the IPC of, in the first cycle, we can do this. We cannot do this because of a dependence. We cannot do this because we are already using our one unit that we have for adds, XORs, etc. We can do the multiply, and we cannot do this add either. In the second cycle, we can do this. We cannot do any of these other two because, again, we are using our add, subtract, XOR unit. This would be in our third cycle. And this would be our fourth cycle. So now we have five instructions over four cycles, and that's equal to 1.25. So this IPC is half of this IPC and half of this ILP. So what we can say is that the IPC has to be less than or equal to the ILP. The ILP is for a perfect processor. A real processor will have some limitations that will maybe allow it to achieve the same IPC as the ILP available in the application, but sometimes it will not. So what we can say is that the ILP is always greater than or equal to the IPC on any real processor. And again, we didn't really need to know what the processor is to compute the ILP, but we do need to know what the processor looks like when we're computing its IPC, and we have seen that the IPC can be equal to the ILP, or it can be lower than that, but it cannot be larger than that.